As our cars get more complicated, there's a lot more controls for the driver to adjust while they're out on the street or the racetrack. And a common way of dealing with this is to put some of those controls or buttons onto the steering wheel. This also creates more problems than it solves because we then need to wire between the steering wheel and the vehicle and get that functionality into our ECU, our dash, or our PDMs. We're here with Zac from Zestek, who's got a really novel solution to this problem of getting those controls onto the steering wheel. So for a start, Zac, what are the common problems that you saw with existing steering wheel mounted controls?
So I see in the market people doing a lot of wirings. So what if we make a PCB out of it and make a product everybody can use instead of doing all this time doing all your wiring? But if you messed up, it's really messed up, right? So it's to create an easy solution for people to using it.
I think the other problem, having gone through this myself, we originally used a little can switch pad and then had individual buttons and rotary switches mounted to the steering wheel, paddles for the gear shift. And then, as you mentioned, you have to wire all of these up. And it's quite fiddly. And anytime we're sort of wiring things like this, it creates a potential for a reliability issue. Safe to assume that a custom designed PCB is going to be much more reliable in a race application?
Yes.
Now, in terms of getting the wiring from the steering wheel to the car, first of all, let's say we've got 6 or 8 buttons, maybe a couple of rotary switches and a couple of paddles. On face value, that sounds like a lot of wires that we need to get across to the car. But when we're using CAN bus, that's not quite the case. It's simplified. Can you explain what we actually need to wire up?
So all we need to wire is like CAN high, CAN low power ground. That's it.
So even for all of those switches and controls I just mentioned, we've only actually got 4 wires we've got to get across to the car.
Yeah, and 4 wire, you can control the whole car. If you want to add more, we have the Pogo pin inside the wheels, so you can do USB signal for your sim racing as well.
Okay, so the Pogo pins that you just mentioned, I want to get onto that now, because conventionally what we've seen when we're wiring a steering wheel to the chassis, obviously the steering wheel has to turn. Yeah. We can't hardwire it that easily, so we usually end up with a curly cord, which in itself, you know, is not that nice. They kind of get tied up, tangled up, and it's something else to remember to unplug and plug in. So how have you dealt with that wiring?
So there is that wiring, so we do the Pogo pin setup, so people don't no longer need the curly cord from the steering column loop around. It might look bad on their show cars, but also with that integrated into the the crinklies, it's much cleaner looks.
So you're actually passing all of those pins essentially through the center of the steering boss into the steering column, and then the wiring's done on the column side of the car?
Yes.
In terms of using the switches on that steering wheel to control functions, are you sending a CAN message, which is great. So how are we then decoding that? Let's say we've got a MoTeC ECU or a MoTeC dash, or maybe a PDM. How do we get those messages into those systems so we can actually control functions?
So for the MoTeC user, we actually have a DBC file for you right away.
For those who aren't up to speed with CAN, what's a DBC file?
So DBC file is a preset. So you can just use it. And if you have a MoTeC, you can just download the file, plug right in, and two devices will talk to each other right away.
So essentially it takes all of the hard work and heavy lifting out of it. All of the CAN messages are defined, so everything just works. No hard work from the user.
Yeah, no hardware for the user. And even for the user who don't know how to do it, we have a CAN spreadsheets. You can just do it right away. And the CAN spreadsheets have the ID and the position for you right away. And you can just load inside the ECU, and then all your tuner will do it for you.
So nice and easy.
Yeah, nice and easy.
All right, so let's talk about setting up some of the switches and how we go about that. Let's say, for example, I might have a button that I want to latch. So let's say it's for pit limiter. I want to press that button once, it turns the pit limiter on. Ideally, I'd like some visual indication that the pit limiter is active. And then when I'm done, I'm exiting the pits, I want to press that button one more time and it unlatches. How would I set that up in the system?
So in the system, we have a race studio, like a OEM CAN bus racing studio. So you can download software and using the latching function there, and all the, because we have LED lighting on each buttons, is a full spectrum RGB. You can do whatever color you want, and you can to do like a flashing or just change colors. So it give you a real feedback on the lighting side, is more visual. So on the traditional level, you press it, you're probably only waiting for your dash or something. You can't really visualize it.
You're not getting that feedback from the steering wheel panel itself.
Yeah, yes.
So am I right here in saying that for that pit limit function that I just mentioned, let's say when I press that button, I want that button to stay backlit, let's say red while the pit limiter is active, and then when I press it again, I want all the color to go away, I could do that?
Yes, you can.
And likewise, if I had another switch, that this one I want to be momentary, maybe it's a headlight flash to warn a car ahead that I'm coming up behind them, I want to be able to press that button and I want it to flash the headlights quickly for, let's say, 3 or 4 seconds, and I want a LED on the steering wheel switch panel to flash to indicate to me that that's happening. Yeah. This is also possible?
Yes.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the paddles as well. So it comes with paddles for paddle shifting, but yeah. Not every car has a sequential gearbox that is paddle shifted. Can we use those for other functions as well?
Yeah. So the one we designed the paddle, it doesn't have to be a paddle. So like all the Formula One car, some paddle is not for shifting, they're for function. So user can use it for your anti-lag launch control or rolling anti-lag or other feature like nitrous. So you can do anything you want with the pedal, depends on your preference. It doesn't have to be pedal shiftings. And it does support CAN bus signals and also support the analog signals. So for people doing like the DCT swap, nowadays really common, it's a really good combo you can using that. And for all traditional one, they're still using airshift, like it's an analog switch, and then you can just use it.
Complete flexibility to essentially do whatever you want, however you want. I also wanted to mention on the back of the steering wheel, I see there is another blue 4-pin connector. So if you don't want to wire through the steering wheel hub, you've got options there as well?
Yes, and it's for user, because some American car, they use still using the old traditional column mounted quick release is kind of different than the one we have. We have to use a basket to fit our quick release on it. So for people who don't want to use our quick release, they can use that instead.
Can you let us know what the price point for the product is?
So our price starting at $13.99.
You also mentioned the ability to use it on a sim rig as well.
Yes.
So, I mean, that would be nice for sort of muscle memory using the same steering wheel and controls on the sim that you're using in your race car. So how does it integrate with the sim?
So we are a company located in Michigan, so which is half the year snow. So when we think about developing it, we're trying to add the sim racing features. I cannot drive my car in the winter. That's the truth, I can't drive it. So when we think about it, why not we just add another set of USB channel in there so people can just use it for their sim.
So for the SIM, you plug in a USB-C connector, is that correct?
Yes, USB-C connector. We have a directly a SIM hub adapters. It will fit our quick release.
Okay, if people want to find out more about the product or perhaps purchase, how are they best to do that?
First, reach out to our distributor and dealer. And if you have any question, just leave us a message on our website or Instagram. We do reply DM as well.
What are those accounts? Give us your Instagram, for example.
Zestek Racing, Zestek Racing. That's our Instagram name. And our website is zestek.net.
Okay. We'll put those in the description as well. We'll make it easy for people to find. Look, Zac, it's been great to get some insight into that product. Certainly an exciting product. I'm using something similar at the moment in our car, and I can definitely see some advantages with your option over the competing products in the market. So thanks for your time.
Yep, thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.